Right. Good morning, everyone. Right. So my name is Rogério, and what I'm talking about today is there is a story behind this. Actually, the story is that I was preparing for my sabbatical this term. I didn't know what to do, so I started looking around. I saw that this very nice school. I started putting ideas together. All right. And that's why I'm here. All right. This is a new community for me. I've come from a soft architecture community. Dependability, security, and this new community. So, I'm taking in this talk, I'm taking the view of change essentially, and change deals with self-adaptation and deals essentially also with microservices. All right. So this is more or less the outline of being an academic. I think it's the first academic. You know, being an academic, this outline of my talk. So there's a motivation. I'm talking about technical debts. One of the things that motivated me to look into this topic. There is a self-adaptation, which is essentially my background here. And I give an example, all right, precise example on self-protection, all right, involving security, which kind of involved with the previous talk without the self-adaptation issues and some conclusions. All right, so let's start from the motivation here. So about 4 years ago, all right, it's a bit unstable this, huh? About 4 years ago, I had a PhD student from industry, actually, and he wanted to do a PhD with me on microservice architectures and self-adaptation. So at that time, I didn't know very much about microservices. So, but when you start looking together, there is a lot of things coming up. All right, there is the notion of self-healing, autonomic controllers, deployment, regression testing, resilience, control of failure, and a lot of things come up essentially because of distributed nature of microservices. All right, which kind of turn around the way you look it into soft architectures. So one issue, a message from that experience took out 1 to 2 years. It was that microservices was emergent fields and was very fuzzy, actually. All right, for it didn't wasn't very clear which kind of problem that we you're going to you're going to focus on. And because there was this notion between centralized and decentralized also, right? This was you were going always playing around with this notion of centralized and decentralized, and essentially will be the topic of most of my talk. So in the meantime, I had a student come to me trying to do some work, and I told her, look, which is the co-author of this paper, actually, this presentation, she wanted to do something on microservice and technical debt. All right. So and I was cool when I she did some studies, of course, and when she came back to me, I was very surprised. All right. So there was no primary or secondary studies analyzing microservices and technical debt. I was very surprised. Nothing there. All right. And I don't know where it is still. And this was quite strange to me because microservices is related to DevOps, related with agile methods. And there is a lot of evidence there of technical debt associated with the agile methods. There is a lot of evidence. So I was surprised that nobody raised the issues. So there was no guidelines essentially for evaluating technical debt in terms of microservices. All right. So this is essentially the two views where I come from for this particular work. So what is the state of art then? All right. What is the state of art in terms of self-adaptation and microservices? Okay, so to be sincere with you, I know a bit from self-adaptation, so there is not very much significant published papers on self-adaptation MSAs. All right. So this is a relatively new field. So it's still establishing, and what I've seen really are some misguided proposals. We can see that. So in the last for the last for this year's SIEMS, we've got 6 publications on self-adaptation and microservices, which is a big compared with last year, with almost none. So there is a growing, at least from the self-adaptation community, there is already a growing view of in terms of microservices. Now, and this issue for me, again, it was surprising, all right? Surprising because essentially both are about change. So both are about change. One deals with change development time, deployment time. Another one deals with change runtime. All right, so the issue here is how to combine that, the notion of change. All right, so, and the idea that it has been very slow of the software engineering community, which is my part of self-adaptation, is that software engineering, software architectures are very much based on centralized entities, feedback centralized control loops, essentially, right? So and you don't and microservice presents themselves essentially in some way on its pure terms as decentralized. So this is very it's been very slow to for the community of self-adaptation to take this up. Another issue also that I've noticed is this notion of architecture and deployment. So from the community of self-adaptation, right, most of the focus of the adaptation of when it started, it was architecture, the system architecture, the soft architecture. So we need components, connections, and what you had to do, either to change the components or to change the connections or to change the architectures of all the configuration. Right, so this is for more than 20 years we've been working on this, so you're able to achieve self-adaptation of systems by changing the architecture of the system, essentially, by adapting the architecture of the system. Right. And there is this difference then. There's a difference between the architecture, the logical design of the application, and its deployment. And that's another thing that you start noticing the difference. I noticed the difference between these two levels of abstraction, essentially. Now, where I come from at the moment. At the moment, in terms of experience, I'm involved in this European project, which essentially is how to share cyber threat information, looking to maintaining privacy and the security. All right, so it's a big system. All right, so at the moment, this is some figures associated with it. So it's a very complex system in which whatever you've got in terms of CTI, cyber threat information, needs to be shared. All right, with other parties, maintaining the security and the safety. So there is a complication. But for you to have an idea, you've got 22 microservices, all right, and the whole process is based on continuous delivery. So you're always updating the system. There are different partners as in European project, all right, 10 to more than a dozen partners, always updating the system. There is a deployment, updating the system, and based on microservices. One issue here, which I must emphasize, and this I think I'll come back later on in the talk, is that this was very much driven on architecture. Before we started doing adding deployment, all right, we take care very much on architecture. So there are companies like HPE, SAP, BT, in which they look very much at the architecture of the system before starting the deployment. All right, so it's not something that you put together, start making the connections, no. And all the connections, all the things, yeah, essentially are asynchronous. Why? Because since there is a request by a prosumer to share some data, or right, the process is there is very clear steps in order to store that data and retrieve that data for analysis. All right, so this is very much a synchronous process. All right, so let's get to the notion that wants motivation to get involved on this. All right, what is technical debt? So technical debt essentially are design decisions that consciously or unconsciously compromise the system-wide quality attributes, right? And what's happening here is that assumptions about architecture, assumption about methods, can affect negatively, right, the microservices system through its lifetime. Right, some decision made today might have impacts on in future on. Right, in future on. So and this is happens every time. So, and I think this message is important because if you are aware of the technical debt, right, and its implications, that might facilitate or might ease the process of taking decisions. Right. If you know what the issues, the problems, the challenge that your system might see in the future, if you can anticipate those, it might help you to support some design decisions. Right. So so what So in order to reduce technical debt, and this I'm going back to all my previous diagram, which you have done this, sorry, my previous diagram. So you need to analyze the quality of tributes. Mostly in this diagram was in terms of security, because we've got the whole security around here. All right, the quality attributes of a microservices system or a system should be analyzed at architectural level. All right. And for the purpose of this paper, of the purpose of this presentation, I'm focusing on three: testing, security, and reliability. And my example will be given in terms of security. All right. So, when you talk about microservices and technical debts, one of the things about testing. So we've got several components, as the previous speakers have mentioned, we've got several components out there. They are communicating, complex communications. How am I going to do integration testing of this? All right. So the integration testing depends on the size of the system. It's just complicated. It's a lot. All right. So that's one issue. In terms of security, and the thing in the previous talk, I mentioned this, all right, there is the attack area increases. There are more APIs available, all right, so attack area increases. There is no global view of the system when they're deployed in different clouds, all right, you don't have control of what's there, all right. The individual microservice might not be trustworthy, all right, so you might not trust once it's compromised, the microservice, you cannot trust, all right. What's the level of trust, mutual trust, and overall there is a system complexity. Whenever the system complexity increases, there is implication in terms of security. And again, in terms of technical debt and reliability, you've got the same problem of the increasing complexity. Increase the number of components, potentially increase the number of communications, the connections, and to handle the failures in communication, handle failures in the components, and this essentially affects the reliability of the whole system. Right? So this is the three issues that I focus in terms of technical debt. Now, when I look into microservices, there is a notion of change. And because I have got always away with glasses in terms of dynamic world, all right, I always think in terms of self-adaptation. And when you talk about the self-adaptation, essentially, we talk about systems that are able to modify their behavior and or structure in response to changes in the system itself, the goals, all right, of the system, for example, or the environment changes. All right. So when I talk about self-adaptation, I'm talking about feedback control loop, all right, and I'm talking about soft engineering techniques. I'm not talking about any other machine learning AI technique. You can abstract really from that. So this is essentially based on well-known soft engineering techniques, essentially. So when I talk about self-adaptation, I can come back to my three points I mentioned before, the testing, security, and reliability, and I'll discuss some issues. So about testing, all right. Testing, the community has already presented approaches in which plans for integration testing can be generated during runtime automatically without any human interference, all right? So you generate the plans according to system changes, you generate these plans, all right, generated plans which are instantiated, which are run and automatically executed. All right, this has been done for already for several years. In terms of security, all right, there is a notion also of self-adaptation. It's trying to protect the system not only against external attacks, for example, distributed denial of services. So you start reconfiguring the system, protecting those components which have been attacked. Or you can have even the situation of internal attacks, in which you start blocking the permissions or the credentials of certain users to use some kind of resources. All right? And this can be done on self-adaptation. There is a system built on this. All right? So during runtime, observes what's the type of attacks that is, and you reconfigure either the structure of the system or you reconfigure the policies that control the access in order to access. And the last one is one of the areas that motivated self-adaptation in the form of self-healing, which is a lot of work there. All right, there is a lot of work there in trying to deal with faults at the component level, faults at the communication level, and faults at the system level. All right, so there is several ways of embedding replication and diversity on the software architecture, which allows to tolerate faults. All right. So, and this is when the things start becoming a bit fizzy in terms of microservices. And the first issue here is this notion between centralized or decentralized. All right. So, are you able to have a component which kind of the control plane from the previous presentation, a component which manages the changes of a microservice system, or this is distributed among several components, all right? And that's already one dichotomy which goes through all the place here. So self-adaptation, all right, relies on the feedback control loop. And the feedback control loop requires models. And those models might be system models, all right? So you've got taken from different perspectives, from the testing perspective, from reliability, availability perspective, from the security perspective. So you build up different models according what you want to monitor and control. On the other side, all right, and this is the notion of orchestration. On the other side, you've got this notion of self-organization. And for self-organization for us, all right, self-organization for us is actually autonomous entities. So when people from this community use the notion of autonomy, I'm kind of, I don't understand what you mean by autonomy, because they're not autonomous, all right? From the concept of autonomous vehicles, they're not autonomous, all right? But I mean self-contained, but not autonomous. So when we've got self-organization, you talk about multiple agents, and colony optimization and swarm. So there is these two extremes here of centralization and decentralization. So one issue is for sure, all right, and this is very much associated with what I mentioned before, some misguided proposals are coming up, all right. So there is no Unix solution for self-adaptive microservices. And you've got to play around between the notion of orchestration and choreography, essentially, all right. So, and depending on the quality attributes that you want to control, you've got to play around with them. They are, all right, and I give example one for orchestration, okay. So, and this is essentially a notion of specialization, generalization of controllers. Why do you've got big controllers which are able to control several quality attributes, all right? Or you start having several controllers which trying to deal with specific attributes, okay? This is an ongoing discussion within the communities. For you to have an example of, patterns for the notion of centralized controllers or self-adaptation, there is a publication from several years ago in which actually we discuss within the MAPE loop, all right? So the MAPE loop, which is classical, sorry, I didn't present this, but this is a classical feedback control loop on self-adaptation, in which essentially we've got the monitoring, analysis, planning, and execution, all right? And the four different phases in the loop, and which you're trying to analyze all that stages. All right, what's happened if you distribute them, what's happened if you centralize them? So if you work with blockchains, this is a very good pattern to work with blockchains. All right. So but if you can see here already. So if you want to every stage communicate with every stage, you start having a messy communication there. All right, which complicates issues, all right? But you can only share the monitoring. So once you've got the monitoring, which was the case before, you can do everything at the different entities, or you can have a planning, all right? So planning centralized and all the others distributed. So you can see that there is already some work which plays around with this notion of how much is supposed to be centralized, the different stages of development. Now, as I promised, how many minutes left? One, I can do in one. So, what I promise here is self-protection. So I give an example of security services based on orchestration, essentially. Now I'm going to pass the thing, but this is an example what should be, all right, what could be a set of containers in which we're trying to identify, all right, and isolate potential malicious containers. Right, so we have got that kind of prototype this for internal threats, but the principle is the same. We've got our containers here, we've got authorization services here, we've got identity services there. All right, so containers request service of containers. Containers has to have to get credentials from identity services. And what you've got at the top here is autonomic controller, which essentially controls all the authorization services. All right, so the policies in this case adapt at runtime and deployed at runtime according with malicious behaviors here. All right, so that's basically what I had to present. All right, so the message here is that for those of you that are aware of self-adaptation, the MapLoop is not the solution for this kind of problem, because there is a lot of issues related to microservices. And the notion of autonomy, I think, is misplaced. All right, so you might be talking about autonomy in the functional domain, but non-functional domain, no way. All right. And what I'll try to do in the future, essentially, is to do this work actually in terms of containers, all right? And that was my 1 minute, I believe. Thank you.
Any questions?
Let me try to connect your presentation to the previous one by Live, who educated us on sidecars and service meshes. Would you see your self-adaptation concepts going into the microservices infrastructure, the service mesh, or into the individual services?
I think we'll go to the mesh. I'm going to have a chat with the previous speaker, but I'm going to go into the mesh.
That's a good
answer. Once you're able to monitor to see what the different microservices are doing, afterwards the issue of analyzing that, all right, see what any problems there, planning for that problems, planning for a solution, and deploy that. All right. So that's why I saw a lot of connections between our issues. All right. So my experience so far has been on the cloud, inside of threats on the clouds, nothing to do with containers, but it might be applied to containers, applied to the mesh level, all right? So that's why I thought it was quite, it calls control plane, all right? It was a big clue there, control plane, there is a kind of feedback there. I didn't quite see the feedback there, but the kinds of feedback there in which starts affecting all the different pods or at work, all right? Is that the case, I believe? Okay, fine. Good talk. All right.
Any other questions? So I propose we thank the speaker again.
Thank you.